They say Brazil is not a country for beginners. Well, Dr. Riordan Roett of the Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies is nobody's beginner.
And we were the first Americans who were detained by the security forces on the grounds that I knew too much about the underground guerrilla movements, that I had kidnapped the West German ambassador, a whole series of other accusations which were not true, of course.
I sat down with the legendary professor to talk about political and economic turmoil in Brazil.
Brazil can't go on the way it has been performing for the last couple of decades. It's really time for a rethink of the Brazilian development model that is addressing long outstanding social questions and finally bringing the fiscal deficit under control and having a plan for growth in the future. That's very difficult because for 10 years, Brazil thought China was always going to buy all their products. That is not the case. China's investment model is changing. It's also true that more and more people over the last 20 years have moved out of the lower class into the lower middle class. They're now falling out of the lower middle class. Unemployment's going up and inflation is going up. So there's a real crisis, social, economic, and political crisis in Brazil.
Now, you talked about people that were able to join the middle class over the last 10 years. We're talking about tens of millions of Brazilians, and there was this tremendous moment of optimism that the country had finally turned a corner. That optimism seems to have dissipated. What happened?
Bad government, bad leadership, and a world economy that turned against Brazil all of a sudden. Brazil was growing very fast. Now, all of a sudden, Brazil is growing, not growing, it's in the negative growth range right now. But the real problem was, as all developing countries, when money is coming in, you spend it, then you overspend, then you've got to borrow, then you're in debt, and then you have to devalue. And that is the case of Brazil, unfortunately. They're in a very serious situation where they probably will need to devalue, hopefully not default. But there's no more money flowing into Brazil. Money is flowing out. They're deep in a corruption scandal that is spreading daily, even as we speak. And they just don't have any good ideas about how to cut spending, which is the critical issue.
Do you think the policy mistakes began in the Lula administration, or was there a failure to react in the Dilma administration?
Well, Lula came first, and he had the good years. He had all the money in the world. He was Mr. BRICS. He traveled a great deal and left other people to run the country. And when you have lots of money, it's fairly easy to run a country, even as big as Brazil. Dilma came in not knowing anything about economics, as we've learned, or about finance, and decided to go on spending. But the bank was running dry. And now the country is paying the price of having to introduce fiscal adjustment, but the politicians don't like adjustment. They like to spend. And so there's a stalemate in Brasilia between Brasilia and the presidential palace, in Brasilia and the Congress, and it's just nothing is happening.
There's a political gridlock in Brazil now, huh?
Multi-party system that is dysfunctional. None of the parties are programmatic, and they're all riddled with corruption. Too many years at the public trough, and they don't know how to back off and to do it. The great thing about Brazil right now is that the federal prosecutors are independent. They always have been since the new constitution in 1988. But they really didn't try to be independent until two or three years ago. These are young, bright men and women who are many trained outside of Brazil in the United States, and they're sending people to jail. The old concept of impunity, which was so strong among the elite and the powerful in Brazil, has now been challenged. And people I would never have thought would go to jail are sitting in jail in Brazil. That's a very positive thing.
Now, we see every day in the newspaper there's a new corruption scandal that hits the front page. Would you say this is an indication that Brazil is business as usual, or is this an indication that that corruption is finally being, as you say, prosecuted and addressed?
It's being exposed, and that's the key thing. And judges are supporting the investigators and the prosecutors, and they're moving forward. They're doing plea bargains. Very modern, very American kind of prosecutorial process in Brazil right now. Very bright young people. And they really are holding people accountable, and they're doing deals to get information out of people. People are telling on others, and this has become a very important part of the new process of rethinking what Brazil should be about in terms of the judicial system. And Brazilians, the average Brazilian, is delighted.
Right, and it seems like some of this political gridlock is all the politicians and political parties pointing fingers at each other. Is that because there really is corruption being exposed, or is this political sniping that's separating the parties.
But one causes the other. I think that everyone feels very, very vulnerable right now in Brazil, as more and more people are being indicted, investigated, arrested. No one knows exactly when the next shoe is going to drop, because probably all of them have had their hand in the till for at some point in their political career. That's how the Brazilian Congress works. And so the real challenge is to find honest people who are going to begin to turn things around, and that's very difficult. Now, when the leaders of the major political parties are all under threat, when the Speaker of the House in the Brazilian Congress has revealed he has $5-6 million in Swiss bank accounts, and the amount of money is overwhelming. There's tens and tens of millions of dollars that have exchanged hands.
People talk about Brazil as a very difficult place to do business. Is that a fair reputation, and if so, why?
Bureaucracy. Terrible tax system, terrible labor laws, all those things really work together. And also a process where Brazilian companies are favored by the government over foreign companies. Lots of subsidies. Brazil is a very closed economy. They don't really believe in competition. The economy is not very productive. It's not very competitive. And therefore, a company coming in from Germany or from Sweden or the United States has to face a very, very opaque process of going through the regulations, gaining approvals, paying their taxes, and these kinds of things.
Has the country actually made significant progress since the return of democracy in the late 80s and early 90s?
Well, Brazil is a marvelous example of how you survive in adversity. They've gone through so many different changes of government since 1985, when the military left and the democratic system was restored, and they've survived all those transitions. Presidents have been impeached. Presidents have been driven almost to the point of retiring. But Brazil goes on. The elections are held. The votes are counted. They're counted honestly. And Brazilians have a great deal of faith in their political system. Not the politicians, but in their political system. And that's very important.
So this too shall pass.
This too shall pass.
Professor Roett, thank you so much for your time. Always a pleasure.
You're welcome, Sam. Thank you.